Good morning, and thank you for joining us for Live at the Cathedral. On behalf of Archbishop Robert Joel Rockford, we welcome you. We're headed into our virtual sanctuary. Get ready to enjoy Jesus with us. Good morning, and thank you for joining us for Live at the Cathedral. On behalf of Archbishop Robert Joel Rockford, we welcome you. We're headed into our virtual sanctuary. Get ready to enjoy Jesus with us. Good morning, and thank you for joining us for Live at the Cathedral. On behalf of Archbishop Robert Joel Rockford, we welcome you. We're headed into our virtual sanctuary. Get ready to enjoy Jesus with us. Good morning, and thank you for joining us for Live at the Cathedral. On behalf of Archbishop Robert Joel Rockford, we welcome you. We're headed into our virtual sanctuary. Get ready to enjoy Jesus with us. Good morning, and thank you for joining us for Live at the Cathedral. On behalf of Archbishop Robert Joel Rockford, we welcome you. We're headed into our virtual sanctuary. Get ready to enjoy Jesus with us. thank you for joining us for Live at the Cathedral. On behalf of Archbishop Robert Joel Rockford, we welcome you. Take this time to like, tag, and share this broadcast with your friends and family. It's time for worship. We're headed into our virtual sanctuary.
Come on, I need you to clap your hands and give God some glory. Come on, give your Lord and Savior, your King, your Maker. Come on, open up your mouth with the sound of the trumpet. Oh, we glorify your name, our Father in heaven. Lift his name on high. The name of Jesus lifted high, lifted high, lifted high. The name of Jesus lifted high. The name of Jesus. this place. The name of Jesus lifted high, lifted high, lifted high. The name of Jesus lifted high in this place. Help me say,
the name of Jesus
lifted high. The name of
Jesus lifted
in this place. Somebody say, release your glory. Release your glory on us now. On us now. On us.
Release your glory. On us now.
In this place. Come on, one more time. Release your glory.
Release your glory on us now.
On us now.
On us now.
Release your glory.
In this place.
Come on now, magnify the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, glorify the name of the Father. Release your glory, oh God. And you are dwelling, seek after. Hallelujah. Jesus, we can't do nothing without your glory. We can't do nothing without your power. We can't do nothing without your healing. Lord, we can't do nothing without your anointing. Lord, we can't do nothing, Lord. And you, I live, I move, and have my being. Lord, I give you glory. I give you honor. And I give you praise. Come on, somebody clap their hands and give them glory.
Grace and peace to life and to our virtual family. Today is the conclusion of our 2021 Men's Conference. And what an awesome weekend and glorious weekend it has been. We begin Friday with Dr. Pastor Tyrone Stevenson, who taught us surgically about the four corners of manhood, which are the spiritual corner, the sexual corner, the emotional corner, and last but not least, the financial corner. And our men's conference continue on Saturday with our presenter, Dr. Ray Morgan, who educated us on how to keep our godly temple healthy for as long as humanly possible. And today is the conclusion of the entire matter, presented by, taught by, and preached by none other than our senior pastor, the prelate of the Dunamis Covenant Connection, and the person of Archbishop Robert Joe Rochford. Let us get with and pray for our spiritual father as he delivers the concluding message to our 2021 Men's Conference. God bless you.
Woke me up this morning. You woke me up this morning. You woke me up this morning, and I wanna thank you for being so good to me, so good to me. One more time, Lord, I just wanna thank you. Lord, I just want to thank you. Lord, I just want to thank you. Lord, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for being so good to me, so good to me. Well, God bless each and every one of you, and welcome to the New Life broadcast as we worship the King who was born that he might redeem and deliver us. This is Christmas season. We call it Advent. And Jesus is the reason for the season. We celebrate him. We honor him. We praise him. While the world talks about reindeers and Santa Claus, we say, oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, the Alpha and the Omega, the chief cornerstone of the church, our beginning and our ending, God manifested in the flesh, the lily of the valley, the fairest of 10,000. He that was and is to come, his name is Jesus. He's the reason for the season. And we give him praise. Share this. Tag others. Let other people know what we're doing. We got to get this message out to the world. Behold, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government there shall be no end. And we thank God for Jesus. Right before I get into the word, I want to make just a few announcements. Of course, you know, prayer continues at 12 noon. I want to thank God for the faithful prayer warriors, all that are joining in. Overseer Curtin, who is facilitating with others to make this prayer happen every day. We have been faithful to prayer, and God's going to be faithful to hear and to do those things that we're asking. He has already started, but he hasn't finished. And let's continue in prayer every day, 12 and then 7 on Wednesday evening. And then on Wednesday, we have Dialogues with Destiny. I know you enjoyed Dialogues last week as we spoke with the men and talked about, this is actually the ending of Men's Weekend, and we had the men on and talked about Christmas in the eyes of Joseph. Them guys were excellent, and I want to thank God for Minister James Robinson, Anthony Robinson, excuse me, and then Overseer Designate Bruce Scott and Overseer Designate Dennis Key for giving us such a wonderful view of what Christmas has to look like in the sight of Joseph. But this week, I got the sisters coming. The sisters going to talk to us about Christmas in the eyes of Mary. There's something about Mary. And we're going to talk about it this Wednesday with the ladies. So we're going to need a little more time. You know, the ladies like to talk. So we're going to need a little more time with the ladies. But join us. Tell others as we come on, and the ladies will be with me, and we're going to talk about Christmas in the eyes of Mary. Please don't forget the Christmas toy giveaway. The CCC, under the direction of Minister Nadine Cook, is having the Christmas toy giveaway. It will be on the 18th of December, Saturday, December 18th at 2 p.m. here at New Life. And it's not too late for you to please buy a toy for ages 2 to 12, an unwrapped toy in a box, or give a donation to be a blessing to the CCC so that they can buy things that will bless the community. We want to show the love of God and let the community know this is a wonderful gift, but the greatest gift you can have is Jesus. But first, we must show them the love of Jesus before we can introduce them to the life of Jesus. So would you help with this toy drive and giveaway? And then lastly, I want to talk about what I call the Gideon Project, and that's the renovation that's going on back in Gideon's Hall. It's coming along well, but we need additional finances and resources to get it done. And as you know, every year, the first Sunday in January, we give first fruits. And the first fruits, or at least a portion of that, will be given to complete that project that's going on in Gideon's Hall. That's why I'm calling it the Gideon Project. Our first fruits are given in increments of 1 through 10 starting with the year. So next year is 2021. So the first would be $222. If you give twice that, that will be $444. And then on and on, three times that, four times that, all the way to 10 times that, wherever the level of your finances and your faith are. I usually try to give in the 10 area, which would be $2,022. But that money is vastly needed as we repair our sanctuary. We coming back. Omicron ain't gonna last. COVID's not gonna last. But God's will, his promise, his blessing, his faithfulness will never end. And we coming back. We know that. But until we do, we must repair. We must keep the sanctuary in good order. And Gideon's Hall that was ruined is being restored. We need your help. That's given on the first Sunday of January. The first fruits offering, the first of the year. We give the Lord the year, $222, or some other increment from 1 to 10. And I believe God's going to do great things in 2022. He's already started, but the best is yet to come. I'd like to thank God once again for Professor Charles Minor being with me, and a musician of the first magnitude. And he has blessed us, had me singing coming on today, and the music was sounding so good. I just had to lend my voice to it. And I want to acknowledge him and thank God for him, JT, and all who are here to help me with this morning's service.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. The Bible says, count it all joy when you face trials of many kinds, knowing that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. He is a God who is timeless, and he is an everlasting God. Thank you, Father. Come on, just begin to worship him. Your God, your Savior, your King, your Maker. We give you glory. We give you honor. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. I will wait on you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you. The Lord is
my light and salvation.
Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my
light.
Whom shall I be afraid? I will trust in you. Till I die,
I will trust in you.
Thank you, Jesus. The song says this: I will remain comforted in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. I will remain comforted in this. The goodness of the Lord.
The Lord is my light and salvation.
Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Come on, anybody waiting on the Lord? I will wait on you. will remain confident in this. The goodness of the Lord. I will remain confident in this. The goodness of the Lord. Come on, why won't you just magnify the name of the Lord right here? Come on, we've been made into a poor night, but joy comes in the morning. Come on, you can cast your cares unto the Lord, and He shall sustain you. Come on, clap your hands right here. We set our hope on you. We set our hope on your love. We set our hope on the one who is the everlasting God. You are the everlasting God. We set our hope on you. Set our hope on your love. Set our hope on the one who is the everlasting God. You are the everlasting God. You
of the Lord. I will remain confident in this. The goodness of the Lord. I will remain confident in this. Goodness of the Lord.
Come on, one more time. Raise it up unto the Father. I will. But He was mindful of you. He knew you before you was in your mother's womb. Come on, somebody glorify Him. Somebody look toward the hills. Hallelujah, which coming from your help. Your help coming from the Lord. Lord, I'm pressing. Lord, I'm fighting. I know we're still living in uncertainty. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what's going to happen the next week. But Lord, we're relying on you. We're relying on your hand. We're giving you glory here.
I've been talking about, remember the theme for this month is making room for the King from Luke. And I spoke on last week from the subject, giving birth to Jesus. And I want to do a sequel to that, giving birth to Jesus. But this time I want to read from Matthew and talk about giving birth to Jesus from the perspective of the gospel written from Matthew. In Matthew, the first chapter and the 18th verse, we now begin. Here begins the reading of God's holy and eternal word. Now, the birth of Jesus was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make a public example of her, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all of this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took to him his wife, and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Once again, I'm talking about giving birth to Jesus. As we're making room for the King, we must give birth to Jesus, who indeed is the King of Kings. There is no birth of our Lord without Joseph and Mary. I spoke to you concerning the fact that Joseph and Mary represent the men and the women of every generation who are called to birth God's prophetic purpose for that generation. They represent the church, because the church is called to reveal to its generation who Jesus is. There can be no light in this world without he who is the light. In him was life, and the life was the light of man, and the light shined in darkness. That's Jesus. There can be no real, authentic love in this world without Jesus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believeth in him should not perish. Real love can only be demonstrated and experienced through Jesus. And then there can really not be any light nor love, but also life without Jesus. He is our life. In him we live, move, and have our being. And as the church, this is a sacred, awesome responsibility, but we must birth Jesus, the light, the life, and the love of God to our generation. Everybody ought to know who Jesus is. Everybody ought to know who Jesus is, especially in this Advent season, because he's the reason for the season. And so now here we have in this text the Christmas narrative. What took place to birth Jesus into this world? Now, we're dealing with Joseph in the text now because this is the end of men's weekend. I'll deal with Mary probably on next week, but I'm talking about Joseph now and his part in the narrative of the Christmas birthing of Jesus. First of all, Joseph is the unsung hero of the text. Most of the time, he's overlooked and forgotten. The story of this miraculous birth centers in Jesus, and we know that that's totally appropriate. It is his birth. Mary carries and births Jesus with her body miraculously, and so we should talk about Mary, and she should be highlighted. But what about Joseph? Joseph is important to this story just like Mary is. And we have to understand that though the birth of Jesus was a miracle and the impregnating of Mary was a miracle, Joseph's part in this was miraculous also. See, you have extraordinary miracles, but then you have ordinary miracles. It is extraordinary that a virgin should bring forth a baby, but Joseph represents the ordinary miracles that take place in our life. It's a miracle you woke up this morning. It's a miracle that after a pandemic and pressure and all of the pain of life, you still in your right mind. It's a miracle that as many times as we fail God, he keeps picking us up because his mercy endures forever. His mercy is a miracle. It's a miracle that in spite of limited resources and financial ups and downs, God keeps making a way. We didn't hit the lotto for $20 million, but day by day, he provides. He pays bills we can't pay, makes ways out of no way. And those are some of the ordinary miracles. Never stop celebrating your ordinary miracles because your ordinary miracles are leading you to an extraordinary miracle. If you can't give God thanks for the ordinary, how will you get the extraordinary? Joseph speaks to us about ordinary miracles. Now, the text begins talking to us about the family of Joseph. The text says that him and Mary are betrothed. Now, this represents what we would call engagement, but in this culture, it is quite different. When you are engaged in this culture, you are considered already married. The Aramaic word for being betrothed is kadashin, and it means to separate or to sanctify. The two people that were betrothed came together before two witnesses, made pledges, sacred pledges, and then were considered married. That was the beginning of the marriage, but it was not until like 9 months later they would have the ceremony and then the consummation of that marriage. So Mary and Joseph were considered already married, but waiting for their ceremony and the consummation. While they're waiting for this time, Joseph finds out that Mary is pregnant. His world comes crushing down. This is a major, major problem and pain for Joseph. Now remember, Mary was chosen to bear Jesus, to carry Jesus, But Joseph was chosen to cover him. What the text is showing us is, what kind of man does God choose to be the step human father, the stepped human father of his son? Because just as God was meticulous in choosing Mary, he was also meticulous in choosing Joseph. Mary would carry Jesus, but Joseph would cover him. And God was very, very particular in choosing Mary, but as particular in choosing Joseph. Joseph speaks to us about the type of man that God can trust with Jesus, that God can trust with his purpose and his will and his plan, that God can use in his generation in a very, very powerful way. A man that will be obedient, a man that will be faithful. We call him a rock. A man that will not be wishy-washy, but will be stable and strong no matter what circumstances he's going through. This we see in the life of Joseph. We see it in his family, and we see it through his faith crisis. Because after the text shows us his family, he's married to Mary. She comes with this news that she's pregnant. He's upset. He's frustrated. His dream has come crushing down. This now turns this text into a faith crisis. And I want you to see some things about this crisis now that Joseph is going through. He was living a dream, getting ready to get married. Now that dream is crushed. But I want you to see some things here. Number one, things are not always like they appear to be. Things are not always like they appear to be. What Joseph thought was a scandal was actually a sacred move of God. What Joseph thought was dirty was actually going to lead to deliverance, because the purpose and the plan of God was working itself out, even though at this time it was painful to him. Sometimes things look one way, but they're another way. And many of the things we're worrying over, we should be worshiping God over, because what we're worrying over will either change in time or God will step in and change it. Why panic when you can pray? Why worry when you can worship? Why be unfaithful and frustrated when you can lift your hands and say, God, I don't know what you're doing, but I still trust and know that somehow this will change, you will change it, or you're going to use it to change me. But something's coming out of this, and though it looks bad, you're still good, and this thing doesn't appear to be good, but you've got a way to work all things together for my good if I trust you and believe you. Things don't always look like they appear. But I want you to also see this. How you act in a crisis reveals who you really are. It's an interesting thing about Joseph. He's not a man of words. He's a man of action. Mary speaks in the Christmas story. Gabriel speaks in the Christmas story. The angels speak in the Christmas story. The only one who has absolutely no word in the Christmas story is Joseph. There's no text that says he ever said anything. Because a real man speaks by his actions, not his words. Every man will proclaim his own goodness, Proverbs says, but a faithful man who can find. Joseph is faithful but doesn't boast about it, doesn't brag about it. Let another man praise thee and not thine own lips, a stranger and not thine own mouth. Speak through how you act, because character speaks through its actions, not its words. And this we see in the life of Joseph. Now watch. The Bible says in the text, Joseph, being a just man, acted in a certain way. Now, let me give you the word for just, the Hebrew term. One of the meanings of it is to feel, act, and think in a way that shows your commitment to the will of God. The word just. To feel, act, and think in a way that shows your commitment to the will of God. Joseph was just, and he shows his justice through his actions. Now, what are the actions? This is important for men. What are the actions that shows whether or not a man is just? Whether or not he feels, acts, thinks in a way that shows he's committed to the will of God. I want to suggest two things. Number one, you know whether a man is just or not by how he treats a woman. Even though Joseph felt frustrated, probably angry and betrayed, his wife has betrayed him, he still treats her in a just manner. You can't tell me a man is just and he's abusing his wife. You can't tell me a man is just and he's getting women pregnant all over the place and not taking care of none of the babies. You can't tell me a man is just and he doesn't respect womanhood, but he sees them as objects of pleasure just to be taken advantage of. You're not just. No, a man that is just will love women, respect women, and treat them like ladies. That's what a just man does. That's what Joseph did. And that's the kind of man that God could trust with his son. The second thing that shows whether a man is just or not is how he handles a wrong that is committed against him. Remember, to Joseph, Mary has wronged him. Gabriel never spoke to him and said that the child was the Christ child born of the Holy Spirit. For all he knows is this woman he was supposed to marry stepped out on him and has come up with this alibi that doesn't make no kind of sense, has never been happened before, and I don't believe none of it. You've done me wrong, and now you're trying to cover your tracks with this ridiculous story about an angel and about the spirit coming on you, and I don't believe none of it. You have done me wrong. But even though he felt he had been done wrong, he would not retaliate. How do you handle offenses? Shows whether you're just or not. You got to understand that if you want God to turn your injustice into a work of his righteousness in the midst of wrong being done to you, then you got to handle it in the right way. You remember what they said, that when you have been done wrong, don't curse it. Don't rehearse it. Disperse it, and God will reverse it. Don't curse it or curse the people that did you wrong. Don't rehearse it. You keep rehearsing it and it'll make you bitter. Disperse it. Give it to God. I don't know why they did this, but I'm giving it to you. I know that there's healing in you. I know that you can take what's broken in me and fix it. You can take this wrong and make it right. I'm dispersing it to you, and guess what? God will reverse it. Don't curse it. Don't rehearse it. disperse it, and God will reverse it. And we see it in this text. Joseph says, I can do three things. He's thinking about it because the text says, as he thought about these things. So he's thinking about it. I can marry her. I can embarrass her and drag her in public and make a public spectacle out of her, which would cause her death, because adultery, even in the period of engagement, was punishable by death. But the last thing he thinks about is what he does. I will handle her like she didn't handle me. She wronged me, but I'm gonna do the right thing. She wronged me, but I'm gonna walk in the integrity of a man and still treat her with mercy and kindness and grace and forgive her for what she did. Now, that's a man. Mm-hmm. You're not known by your muscles, you're known by your heart. It's not the size of your muscles that makes you a man, it's the size of your heart. And Joseph shows us in this text that his heart was biggest, probably the biggest thing that he had, because in the midst of being wrong, he loved her, forgave her, and treated her right. He's going to secretly, so that nobody knows what's going on, and she could go on with her life without embarrassment, without any kind of shame. He is a man's man. That's Joseph. This is how he handles his faith crisis. Can you have confidence in your challenge? Can you receive wrong and still do right? Can you believe that God can take what people do to you that is offensive and wrong to you and yet bring something out of it that blesses your life and blesses the lives of others? That's the God that we serve. That's what God promises to do when we trust him and don't try to get even or get angry at poke and try to retaliate. Leave it in the hands of God, and God will fix it, fix you, and turn the whole thing around. We see this in the life of Joseph in this Christmas story. Now we've seen the family of Joseph, the faith crisis of Joseph. Now I want to shift the text into the faithfulness of God towards Joseph. And I want to encourage somebody listening to me, you cannot be faithful to God and God not be faithful to you. In fact, when we're unfaithful to God, he remains faithful. So if we can be unfaithful to God and he remain faithful, imagine what he will do for us when we're faithful to him. His faithfulness will be seen greater in our lives because we show our confidence, our trust when done wrong, when dealing with issues and problems and painful situations, and yet leaving it in his hands and knowing that he can do something about it, or change us through it. When we are faithful to God, he's going to prove his faithfulness to us. Well, what's the first thing that happens? The scripture says that while he was pondering these things, he had a dream. And in the dream, the Lord said to him, "Fear not. This thing ain't like what you think. You think this is a scandal of man, but it's actually a sacred move of God." The first thing that God did in showing his faithfulness was to show Joseph, your pain is not as great as my purpose. And your pain has a purpose. Nothing you go through doesn't have some purpose that God can't work. Nothing you go through will be wasted. Nothing you go through will leave you where you are, but will move you in character and faith and in purpose to where God wants you to be. No matter what your pain is, God has a purpose for it, and your pain will not be greater than your purpose or outlast it. That's the first thing. I want you to see here how Joseph is living this nightmare. But then God gives him a dream. God, I'm talking to some folks and Bishop, my life seems like it's a nightmare. I'm here to tell you that God is the God that takes nightmares and turns them into daydreams. There's a daydream coming. I prophesy to somebody, the nightmare is over. You've been dealing with a nightmare. Things have had you upset and frustrated. People have been doing you wrong. And enemies have been fighting you. And everything that could go wrong has been going wrong. Your wild spinning out of control. The bottom dropping out of everything. A nightmare. But I came to prophesy, your nightmare is about to shift into a daydream. Yeah, faithful to God. He gotta be faithful to you. I want you to see in this text, he says, Joseph, son of David. He takes him back to covenant. David is from the tribe of Judah. Joseph was from the tribe of Judah. Mary was from the tribe of Judah. Judah is Yada. To lift your hands in praise. There's no J in the Hebrew. It's actually Yada in the Hebrew, but in the English we say Judah. Yada is to throw your hands in praise. I want to remind you, Joseph, you've been living a nightmare, but you belong to Judah. And the first promise given to Judah, you are whom your brethren shall praise. Your hand shall be in the neck of your enemy. Judah, you may go through pain, but you're coming to prominence. Judah, you can't die a victim. If you're a praiser, you're going to come out. If you're a praiser, God's going to turn some stuff around for you. If you're a praiser, God's going to right the wrongs done in your life. Don't worry about the people that did you wrong. Give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor. And watch him make right out of what's been wrong. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue that rise up against you shall be utterly condemned. God's got a way of making a way out of no way and taking a mess and working a miracle in it. I don't know where you are, in your house, on your job, but take a moment and give God praise. He's working some stuff. He's making some things happen. He's doing some things that's gonna make sense out of what doesn't make sense right now. That's what the Christmas story tells us. God is up to something. You may be crying, but he's up to something. You may be having it hard, but he's up to something. People may be betraying you, but he's up to something. Enemies may be fighting you, but he's up to something. And I dare you to take some time and say, I will bless the Lord at all time. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make a boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. You got a covenant, and the covenant says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord shall deliver him spite of them all. But lastly, I want you to see in the faithfulness of God, Joseph thought he lost everything, but in God's plan, he wasn't losing Mary. He was gaining Jesus. He thought he was losing his marriage, but God was giving him the gift that keeps on giving, Jesus. Joseph, fear not to take Mary to be thy wife, because the two of you are going to birth Jesus for your generation. In spite of your pain, Joseph, you're going to birth Jesus for your generation. In spite of the misunderstanding and the wrong you thought done, you're going to birth Jesus for your generation. And you shall call him Jesus, because he gonna save his people from their sin. You thought you lost a loving wife, but in actuality, I was taking you through what you went through so that you could gain a powerful Savior, Jesus. He who lived and died and rose from the dead. Jesus, whose blood is efficacious. Jesus, through his name, remission of sins is given. Jesus, who can turn your life around. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Joseph, you are not losing everything. You're gaining more than you lost, because I'm giving you Jesus. And I want to pray now for those of us who are the church, who must now go through the pain and the pressure and the problems in our own narrative of the Christmas story, to birth Jesus to a family that may be rejecting him, to birth Jesus to loved ones who don't know he exists, to birth Jesus to co-workers that may be addicted to drugs or may be having depression to the point that they're suicidal, but your light and your life and your love expressing who Jesus is might be the very thing that redeems and saves them. Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save. He's Emmanuel, God with us, and his purpose is to be with us to save. And I want to pray for you that God will use you mightily through the midst of pain, pressure, and problems, yet to birth Jesus, that those who you know and love can know the Christ child. And Father, we thank you. We honor and praise you. We celebrate your holy name. Grant us grace not to return wrong with wrong, but to love even when we're done wrong. To disperse whatever may happen to us so that you can reverse it. Bring it for your glory and our good. Bless these, your people. It's not easy birthing. And it's certainly not easy birthing Jesus to our generation, because we cannot birth him without pain and pressure. But anoint them with the grace of Joseph to stand strong like a rock no matter what they face. I pray for the men at this end of men's weekend that you'll help us to be Joseph-like men that have character, men that are just, men that love you, men that love their families, men that raise their children, men that leave a legacy of righteousness and justice. We pray that prayer. Bless every family, the single mother, the single father, the nuclear family, whatever family it is, like you bless Joseph, Mary, and the Christ child, bless us to fulfill your purpose and will in spite of all that we face. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, I want to pray for those of you that may not know the Lord. He came to save. You say, preacher, my life just isn't what it ought to be. He came to save. You say, preacher, I don't know what I'm going to do with these children, raising them by myself, halfway making it. I feel so uncertain. That's why he came. You need Christ. Don't think twice. You need Christ. And if you need him, I want you to pray this prayer with me right now. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life. Make me God's child. Give me your light, your life, and your love. And I will serve you for the rest of my life. If you prayed that prayer and meant it, you have now connected to Jesus. And because you're connected to him, you will now experience his light, his life, and his love. You're saved. That's what the meaning of saved is, to be reconciled with God. I want you to text SAVED to 55444. Text the word SAVED to 55444. And then I want you to see how God's going to do great things in your life as we pray with you. And as we show you how to live now this new life in Jesus. He was born so that you could be born again. And that's his name, Jesus, the Savior of the world. God bless you. Well, it's giving time. We want to be a blessing to the body of Christ, to the house of the Lord. Because we are called to birth Jesus to this generation. I'm so thankful that God chose me, like he did Mary and Joseph, to be part of this birthing of the mind and the will and the purposes of God, the revelation of God to our generation. You and I are chosen to do this, and one way we do it is by financing the mission of God to this world. New life is here to bring new life to New York. And every dime, penny, nickel, and dollar we give helps us to fulfill this mission, taking Jesus to the world, teaching, touching, and transforming the world through our Lord Jesus Christ. There are several ways you can give. You can give by Cash App, $NewLifeNY. You can go to the website www.newlifeny.org. You can give by Givelify. And, you know, if you still give by check or whatever, then when we do in-person service, you can certainly do that at that time. But this is, of course, not the in-person service. So just follow the prompts on the screen. And you can give in one of those ways. But give. The Christmas season is about giving. God so loved the world, he gave his son. The son so loved us, he gave his life. And if we value what he's done for us, then let's value what the church can do in bringing his life to others. And give our resources so that we can reach this world through Jesus Christ. While you're giving, remember 12 noon prayer every day. Don't forget Dialogue with Destiny this Wednesday night. I'm going to have some Marys on with me. And we're going to talk about Christmas in the eyes of Mary. Please remember the Christmas giveaway that we're having. You can donate toward that. Even today, just put down there CCC, so that they'll know that that offering is going for the CCC ministry. Or you can buy a boxed gift from ages 2 to 12 and bring it to the church. drop it by the church, and the CCC will have it so that they can give it away. And then don't forget the Gideon Project. We're repairing the house of the Lord. Our Gideon's Hall was ruined, mildewed. We had to pull up the carpet and do, but look how it's coming along. The floors are going down. The walls are up, and I mean, it's coming together, but we need some added resources. And I'm asking on the first Sunday of January that we remember our first fruits, $222 in increments of 1 to 10. And you'll hear more about that, but prepare yourselves for it, because we're going to get this job done for Jesus. Mm-hmm. We're strategizing, we have strength, and we will have success as we continue to follow God's plan, though it be painful, though we be processed, but in the end, nightmares will turn back to daydreams. And that's what the Christmas story is all about. Well, God bless you. Thank you for your time. I'm out of mine. But God is good, and we give him praise. I'm going to pray now, and we will be dismissed. The Lord bless you until we meet again, either through the cyber world or in the congregational church in the sanctuary. The Lord bless and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you, and give you his peace. Father, bless your people. Your hand be upon them. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen. God bless you, saints.